Yeah, welcome back to Numerical Methods. So we started discussing how we can approximate partial derivatives. Okay, and actually the first session was very, very easy. We just used the Taylor expansion, and by plugging in different points, we got equations, yeah, using Taylor expansions. And then by nicely combining the equations, we can single out expressions for certain derivatives. And we derived here, for example, at these three different approximations for the partial derivative of dv by dx. Okay, so we had the forward difference, forward finite difference approximation, v of x minus v of x plus h minus v of x divided by h. And we had two different versions, v of x minus h divided by h, the backward one and the centered one, v of x plus h minus v of x minus h divided by 2h. And now I'd like to do this little numerical experiment with you, approximate the derivative of the exponential function at x equals 0. So I know the exponential function has slope 1. So maybe I draw a little exponential here. So there's 1. Then I have something like that. And if I use, say, a forward finite difference, so in this numerical experiment, I would like to use a forward finite difference. You see that in order to get the right slope, I should maybe make x plus h as close as possible to x. So this here is x equals 0. This here is just h. So maybe I should make h as small as possible. Okay, so numerical experiment, let's try that in a computer and try some values. So there are a few suggestions for values here. And also if you later like to look at the code, you can download the code from this Git repository. So let's create here a new class that should have a main method where I do my little experiment. And how do we call this guy? Yeah, so let's call it finite difference experiments. Okay, I just do one maybe today. I like to calculate the derivative of a function at a certain point. So this should be my x, and then let's print the forward finite difference approximation of the exponential function at this x using a certain shift value h. So maybe I use a small number. So let's use 0.0.1. No? So don't know if this is sufficient. So this here is now my shift h, which I pass to this function. Okay, so and I implement now our approximation here in this function. So he's complaining that the method is not existing. So let's create this. So this here is my shift. Yeah? So this is the shift h. Okay, so what has to be done? I need to calculate the value at the upshifted value. So calculate the exponential at x plus h, x plus the shift. So this is the upshifted value. Then I need to calculate the unshifted value, the v of x. So this is just exponential of x. Calculate exponential function here. And then I calculate my finite difference approximation. So my finite difference approximation of dv by dx, yeah, so of the derivative, this is just the upshifted value minus the value v of x minus v of x plus h minus v of x divided by h. So divided by the shift. And let's print this out, okay? So let's print this a little bit nicely. So let's first print out the age. So let's have some formatting here, because I just need maybe two digits for the age, so, or three digits. So let's have something, using 10 to the power of notation. Yeah, so let's print first the shift. Okay, and then just print some tabulator, and then print the result. So this is the finite difference approximation. Okay, so this is delta V divided by delta X. Yeah, so this is just say a delta. So a delta is 0.394. So this is delta V divided by H. Okay, so and my finite difference approximation is then this stuff we have calculated. Okay, so maybe okay, so that should be it. Maybe I run this program. So let's run this program and check what is happening. Okay, so my finite difference approximation V of X plus H minus V of X, so my delta V divided by H, is 1.005. So maybe I have an equal sign here to make that a bit nicer. So I know the analytic solution is one. Yeah. So we know that there is here an error 0.005. So maybe I take a smaller shift. So suggestion is take a smaller shift and let's check if we get convergence. Convergence should be order of H. So I believe that if I make it 10 times smaller, my error is also getting 10 times smaller. Okay, and that seems to be true. Yeah. So here I have an 0.005. Yeah. So one is the true solution. So now I get 1.0005. So 10 times better. So let's make the approximation even better. So it should be again 10 times better, so 1.0 more, and that's true. 0.0.0. Okay, so let's make it really precise. Yeah, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Now let's use 10 to the minus 16. Okay, let's use 10 to the minus 16, a really small number. So I use here 1e minus 16 as the shift. And I assume that is now a very good approximation. Okay, so and you see, bam, I get 0. Well, that's not what I expected. Yeah, so there's a small surprise here. Maybe not for you, because you know computer arithmetics and you know that maybe there is an issue because we used a very small number here. Okay, so that number was too small. Yeah, okay, 10 to the minus 16. Yeah, clearly that is too small. Let's use 10 to the minus 15. Yeah, but that should work. Okay, so let's use 10 to the minus 15. And I would like to get a good approximation. Okay. And the funny thing is that, okay, yes, it is maybe an approximation, but it's the worst one of all these guys. Yeah? So not the worst one. This one here has an error of 1. Yeah, it should be 1. But it's even worse than using here 10 to the minus 2. Yeah, even worse than using 0.01 as the shift. Okay, I have here an error of 0.11, yeah, 11% of an error. That's really bad. So what should I use now? Let's take 10 to the minus 12. Is 10 to the minus 12 better? Okay, yes, 10 to the minus 12 is better, yeah, but still it's worse than 10 to the minus 4. Okay, so what is going on here? That's really an issue. So I do not know the right shift. And if we go back to the script, we wrote here the remark, we should maybe make h as small as possible. But actually, this does not hold in the computer. Okay, so for the computer, it's maybe not good to choose h as small as possible. Okay, let's get an intuition of what is going on. No, and really, this is very nice, yeah, because now we can maybe understand what is going on there by plotting the function of how does the error, so the stuff that becomes here after the one, so I will subtract one, the analytic solution to get the error, how does this error depend on my shift size? So I would like to plot this function. So let's create here another method. So let's call this method plot forward finite difference approximation of exponential or say approximation error. So we will plot the approximation error. So let's plot that for this given x. So our x is always the zero. Okay, so our x is always the zero, yeah. And I would like to plot now the error as a function of the shift. So let's create this method here and define this function. So let's call this here finite difference approximation error. Okay, so this function maps the shift that we use to the approximation error. So let's just do the same stuff that we did below, calculate the upshift value. So that's the exponential of x plus the shift. Calculate the downshift value. Or we use forward finite difference to calculate the unshifted value. So that's just the exponential of x. Calculate the finite difference approximation. So that is the value upshifted. What's going on here? Minus the downshift value divided by the shift size. So that's now my finite difference approximation. Then calculate the analytic solution of the derivative. So I know I'm differentiating the exponential function. So this is analytic. The exponential function again. So exponential x is the analytic derivative. Then I calculate the error, which is the difference of my finite difference approximation. And the analytic solution. So that's my error. And I'm now returning this error. Sorry, this is the error. So, okay. So, and I'm returning this error. So, this is now just the definition of this function, which calculates for every shift, so for every little h, the approximation error, yeah, between the finite difference approximation and the analytic solution. And now I just would like to plot this function. So, I have a small plot helper code here. So let's create a two-dimensional plot. Let's calculate from very small shifts. So let's take 10 to the minus 16 up to 0.01. So this is the x range. Let's use a few points here for this and calculate this finite difference approximation error function. So then I can, I need to import this here, okay. And then I can maybe add some title. So let's set some title. So this is the one-sided finite difference. Approximation of the derivative of exponential x at x equals x. Let's also set the x-axis. So my x-axis is the shift. And let's also set the y-axis. So the y-axis is the error. So just make it a bit nice and then let's show this guy. Okay, so let's check what we will see if we just plot this function. So I hope I did everything right. Maybe we have to adopt it a little bit. Okay, so, and we see that the error is actually, okay, zero, yeah? And then if we take very small values for the shift, okay, then we see that suddenly it breaks down. Okay, actually currently I don't see anything. So maybe the plot is not very nice. So the thing is that what I did here was I took 10 to the minus 2, 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 16. Maybe I should plot this on a logarithmic scale and check what is actually the scale doing. So instead of plotting this as a function of the shift, which we can maybe investigate also, again, let's investigate it as a function of a scale. So there's a parameter scale, and my shift is actually calculating as 10 to the scale. So now I can calculate here 10 to the minus 16, 10 to the minus 15, and so on. So, and now I would like to plot this for 10 to the minus 16. Say, let's start at 16.5 to say some value, say 10 to the minus 12. Okay, so because at 12, we already also observed it's getting slightly better, yeah. And let's plot this now as a function of scale. So here the x-axis is now not the shift, it's the scale, and the scale is the logarithm of h. Yeah. Actually, it's the logarithm base 10 of h. Okay, and let's plot it again. So now you see that here this is a scale. Scale is logarithm base 10. So maybe I can also write that. So a subscript 1 and subscript 0. Okay, so my scale is log 10 of h. So this here is 10 to the minus 16. 10 to the minus 15, 10 to the minus 12. And you see, 10 to the minus 12, the error is already becoming small. Yeah, it's not zero, but if you zoom in here, you will see that there is something going on. But here in this region, 10 to the minus 16, 10 to the minus 13, there is some stuff going on. Okay, so we have this strange picture here. So there's also some wiggling going on here. The wiggling is smaller. So we saw 10 to the minus 12 is already here at 10 to the minus 5, yeah, something like that. So the error is already smaller, but here it's minus 1, plus 1. We have a huge error here. Okay, so it's not clear. Take the shift as small as possible. There is a certain forbidden region. It's not clear what we should take as a shift. So let me analyze this picture here a little bit. Why is this picture looking like that? Okay, so what's going on? So what are we actually doing here? So I'm calculating the error of my finite difference approximation. So I'm calculating exponential h minus 1 divided by h. Exponential x plus h, but x is 0, minus exponential of x is 0, so minus 1, divided by h. And that here is my approximation for the partial derivative. So my error is this approximation minus the analytic solution, and the analytic solution is also exponential of 0, so that is 1. So this plot is this error as a function of h, where we are actually here on the x-axis plotting the scale, though the exponent 10 to the scale. We are using very small values of h. So if h is small, this means that exponential, so h is positive. So maybe I write this. So h is, say, positive and small. So this means exponential h is in the interval between 1 and 2. Yeah? So clearly 10 to the minus 14, it will be smaller than 2. So what does this mean if you represent exponential h in the computer? And now we go back to our very first session where we were looking at computer arithmetic and where we were talking about how the computer represents numbers. And a number between 1 and 2 is represented here as this normalized floating point number. So we have here this representation. The sign is positive, so this guy is not there. So I have 1 plus c divided by 2p multiplied with 2 to the power of e. And since I am in between 1 and 2, this e here is just 0. And it just depends on the c. C equals 0 is 1, and c equals 2 to the power of p. Yeah, actually, that's not possible. 2 to the power of p minus 1 is the last number before 2. So I have that the floating point number that represents the solution exponential h is of the form 1 plus c divided by 2 to the power of p. And note that for floating point double precision, this p is 52. Okay, so I have that exponential of h is of this form. So now you know that for h small on the mathematical side, I have that exponential of h is approximately 1 plus h. Now this is just Taylor expansion up to the first linear term. Okay, so if you compare the two, and if you now apply the mathematical inverse to the floating point number, this means that I would expect that h is c divided by 2 to the power of p. So I have that exponential of h is approximately, the true value should be approximately around 1 plus h. And I have that the floating point representation of exponential h for a number that is close to 1 is of this form. So actually I know that if there is no error, yeah, it should be that h is actually c divided by 2 to the power of p. So now these numbers live on a very different scale. This here is a number that is, assume c is equal to 1. Yeah? So this is a number 1 divided by 2 to the power of p. This is a number that is 2 to the minus 52. This is something like a 10 to the minus 16. This is a very small number, 10 to the minus 16. And this here is just 1 plus a small number. Let's draw now these two different scales. So I draw here the values that I have for the exponential of h. And what results can I get? I can get the result that is 1. So this corresponds to c equals 0. Okay. Then the next result that I can get is the one that is 1 plus 1 divided by 2p. So this is 1 plus 1 divided by 2 to the power of p. So this corresponds to c equals 1. And then another, the next number, the next result that I can get is 1 plus 2 divided by 2 to the power of p. So this guy corresponds to c equals 2. I can get these results, and then I can get other results. But there's no number here, okay? So the computer cannot represent anything in this interval. These are the numbers, these are the results that he can represent. So this here is the result of my little operation. I like to move this a little bit up, but maybe I can move it here. So now I have more space. So this is the result of exponential of h. Now look at what happens to h. So let's draw another line here because h is small. And we know that this value here, 1 plus 1 divided by 2p, corresponds to c equals 1. So this value would correspond to h equals 1 divided by 2p. Maybe I just draw this guy here. So here I have 1 divided by 2 to the power of p. This here is now the argument. So my shift in this little experiment, the argument h. And clearly this guy here is then mapped by the exponential of h to this value here. And this guy here, which is 2 divided by 2 to the power of p, is mapped to this guy here. Okay? So h is c divided by 2 to the power of p, and exponential h is approximately 1 plus c divided by 2 to the power of p. There are no numbers here in between, but there are many numbers in between here. Okay, so why is that? So if you think back of the normalized floating point numbers, it is 1 plus c divided by 2p multiplied with 2 to the power of e. So for c equals 0, this number is 2 to the power of e. And this guy here is just a 2 to the power of minus p. So this here corresponds to e equals minus p, and the c equals 0. And of course, C equals 1, C equals 2, and so on, will create all these numbers here in between. These guys. Okay, and also there are a few guys here on the left because I can get smaller. I can get I can set e to minus p minus 1 and get even smaller numbers. So there are also smaller numbers here. And there are also more numbers here. So now we have that all these numbers which are here in this blue interval will actually map all to the same point. They all map to the same point. That's a bit ugly. Okay, so there is rounding. And the only point which has almost no rounding error, yeah, so almost because actually I used here the approximation that exponential h is approximately 1 plus h, okay? So the only point that has almost no rounding error is here this point 2 divided by 2 to the power of p. Because exponential will then be 1 plus 2 to the power of 2 divided by 2 to the power of p, which is approximately the right result. And in between, I will have a rounding error. And when does the rounding flip to the new value? The rounding will flip to the new value if we are here. So what's this point? This point is 1.5 times 1 divided by 2p. And if I'm crossing this point, actually I will flip, the result will flip to the other point. Okay, that's interesting. Let's try a few shift sizes h which have these values, okay? So let's try these values and then we will suddenly understand this picture. So let's go back here and try a few other points here. So let's try, for example, 1 divided by 2 to the power of p. So that's 2 to the minus 52. Okay, so let's try that guy. And you see, this is a very small number, yeah? 10 to the minus 15 had a huge approximation error, and this guy is exact. Let's try a few other guys. Let's try 0.51, so half of this. Let's try 1.0 of this. And let's try 0.49. So this here is approximately 1/2 times this. This here is 1 times this. So times 2 to the power of minus 52. No? 1 divided by 2 to the power of p. And let's try also say 1.5. Okay, so let's try these guys. Okay, so we will see for this point, which is 1/2, it's 0. Then suddenly it jumps to almost 2. For the in-between points, it is 1. And for the point 1.5, it is jumping to 0.3. Yeah, so the error jumps to 0.3. So it jumps to 1.3. So this number here is, the error is approximately 1. This number here, the error is 1/3. And here the error is 0. So we observed that the result was zero for very small numbers. Yeah, so the error was minus one. Then the result was 1.9 at a certain point. The error was jumping to 0.9. And then at another point, the error was 1/3. So the error was 0.3. Which is here. Okay, and in between, there is a certain point that has no approximation error. So let's take the zero here. So there is a point here that has no approximation error. And now let's check what these points are. So the claim is that we do not have an approximation error actually for this point here, which is C equals one. Which is this guy here, 1 divided by 2p. We do not have an approximation error for this. And then the flipping between the two intervals. So the approximation error, if we move slowly here up, the approximation error is growing. And then suddenly there is a flipping to the next interval. And this flipping occurs here at this line. So this jump here should be exactly at 1/2, 1.5 times 1 divided by 2 to the power of p. So how do I get these points? So the scale that I plotted here is the logarithm base 10 of h. So what I need to calculate is the scale which is logarithm base 10 of c divided by 2 to the power of p. Maybe I just do that with a calculator. So I have a small calculator here. So let's calculate 2 to the power of 52. So then 1 divided by that. So this is 2 times 10 to the minus 16. So something that looks familiar to us. And let's take logarithm base 10 of this. So I get minus 15.65. So this is this point, minus 15.65. Okay, and you see, this is the point where we have by coincidence, no approximation error. And this point here, so what's that guy? So we would assume that it is 0.5 times this. And this point here is 1.5 times this, where this is actually 1 divided by 2 to the power of p. So maybe I try here the orange one. So 2 to the power of 52, 1 divided by 2 to the power of 52, multiplied with 1.5 is that. Take logarithm base 10 of that, minus 15.48. Let's check. Oh, this is maybe minus 15.48. Okay, so you see that these points here where we get these jumps in the graph are actually just the points where the rounding is flipping to the next possible representation of the result for the exponential of h. Yeah? So actually, we have just our plain old problem with the rounding error here. And now you see that our lemma does not hold. You cannot choose h as small as possible to get the best or most accurate result. So to conclude here with the script, there's a small summary. So for small h, I have exponential of h is between 1 and 2. So exponential of h is a normalized floating point number, which is 1 plus c divided by 2p. So if I then use here this approximation that exponential of h is approximately 1 plus h, this means that h is of this form. And now we have that the computer can represent many different values for the h in this interval. But the result is only rounded to very few values. So actually, if you are in between two values of c, yeah, you are just rounded either to one or the other guy. And I also have here this small table where you can calculate from the c this scale parameter in the plot, and you can verify that these are exactly the points where the result is jumping. So actually, there is a small no here. Yeah? So we should not take h as small as possible. And the reason is that we have the rounding errors from computer arithmetic. And now it becomes interesting because now I can ask myself, okay, what is the best possible h? So there's one argument, reduce the approximation error from the Taylor expansion that makes h small, that suggests that h should be small. And there's another argument, so reduce the loss of significance that actually suggests to make h large. And we will do this in the next session when we derive error estimates, where we actually include the computer arithmetic rounding error in the error estimate and then derive the optimal shift. That was it for today. Thank you.